Matt Inchinito, and I'm with CDWG. Hey, you're in Clinton. And today is just a pretty fast overview of a bunch of things related to cloud services related to Microsoft. There's a lot of stuff, a lot of offerings, a lot of things have changed. Offerings have changed just even over the last year. They've accelerated a lot. And so it's really just an opportunity to kind of introduce you to all that's, you know, as much as I can in half an hour, without being overwhelmed, and try to, you know, keep it interesting, but, you know, give you the pertinent facts, enough to, I guess, wet your whistle. I guess that's the purpose of what we're doing today. So with that, I'll just kind of get started and talk about things related to, and just so you know, so I'm going to start out with some of the IT-related stuff. Frankly, I'm going to talk a lot less about Office 365 per se, although I'll touch on it, but more getting to some of the stuff that's more in the IT and infrastructure as a service and platform as a service side of things. So hopefully that makes sense for this audience. I know I've done this a number of years in a row, so that should be appropriate. One of the first offerings that I want to share with you about is called the Enterprise Mobility and Security Suite, also known as EMS. It's a little bit renamed. It was Enterprise Mobility Suite. Now it's Enterprise Mobility and Security. EMS is first thing to remember is that it's a package, a bundle. It has a number of different offerings within it, and most of those offerings are also offered on an a la carte basis. So it's really important with all of these to work with whoever your reseller is. If it's us, I'm a good resource for you to talk about the licensing side of things and how to evaluate costs based on, here's the stuff that we need. We're not using everything in the suite, but does it make sense to go to the bundle after all? Because a lot of times you'll hear about things in terms of the whole bundle, and often that makes sense, but not always. So keep that in mind, and that's my recommendation in terms of evaluating it. We'll kind of go through what's in EMS in general. I am not a product in-depth IT expert. I'm a licensing specialist, so the easiest way to understand it is I know a lot of the what, as in what's in it, but how does it work and what does it do? I welcome those questions, but chances are I'm not the guy who can answer them. However, we have at CDW a very large team of pre-sales resources. I've got a lot of smart people that I can work with, so I can get you answers as a follow-up. So if you have them, by all means, ask them, but we'll just have to see what they are if I've heard the answers from someone smarter than me in the past. Okay. The first major component that's in Enterprise Mobility Suite is Azure Active Directory. Keep in mind, Azure AD, if you have Office 365, there's a basic edition that comes as native to Office 365. So it's the directory service that's in the cloud for Office 365. So that's the basic edition, and that's where users' identities remain in the cloud. Active Directory Premium adds a number of features, security related as well as identity related, and could be valuable. So AD Premium is in the EMS suite. In terms of the security side of that AD Premium, what you're getting additional is the things that matter the most that I hear customers really gravitating towards are the multi-factor authentication. Really, the behavioral analysis and conditional access, those are cool features. I don't hear customers really making a switch based on those features. favor. And then the single sign-on, we're talking about true single sign-on. So log in once, sign into all your cloud services. Azure Active Directory will allow you to attach applications, all sorts of apps, thousands of them, from a catalog of different apps, not just Microsoft apps. So any cloud services that you're using, Moodle, I mentioned Blackboard, things like that, AD Premium can give you a single sign-on, MFA, and your password right back into those, in addition to some security features. Also included in EMS is Azure Rights Management Services. So it can enforce authorization policies. You can kill documents remotely and integrate into other apps. Also, not the most common feature that tip the scales for Enterprise Mobility Suite. Intune, however, is very common, and Intune has a number of security features as well as mobile device management capabilities. That's really where most people, that's what you want to be thinking about when you think about Intune. Intune is also available a la carte, as well as in suite. Conditional access, compliance enforcement, so you have certain security patches and updates that device needs to meet before you allow them into your network. Intune can help you manage that with your remote users and on-premise. Mobile app integration. But the thing that I think about Intune is software deployment, so application deployment, updates to remote users, and conditional access and other MDM features. Intune is available for, as I mentioned, it's available a la carte as well as in the package. One of the things to know too is that in terms of pricing, if you license all of your users, whether through the suite of EMS or Intune a la carte, students get Intune for, you get Intune for your students for no additional cost. So these are kind of some of the licensing things to keep in mind too, and make sure you're just asking about that. Advanced Threat Analytics. ATA, I'm going to go to the next slide because it's actually more more useful. ATA, or Advanced Threat Analytics, it's a algorithm-based analytics tool that allows you to identify threats and threatening behavior. And really importantly, it also helps you identify, look, you've got threats. The threats are happening. The real question often is, which ones are really important to tackle, and which ones can I leave for the time being? Because the understanding is it's generally impossible to deal with every single kind of threat that could be happening at any given time. So it's really about which ones are important, why are they important, and what's going on. ATA is pretty cool because it adapts and it learns behavior of your users, so it can compare those behaviors to erratic behaviors and give you reports. So you're not getting overwhelmed with information, you're getting information that matters. So it's really a modern analytical tool. And then cloud app security also included in EMS. So you can set things like access, data loss prevention, data sharing, deep control at the application level as well. So the whole thing with EMS is that it's designed to help you control at the user level, application level, file level, to give you a different, to help you prevent threats and information getting out when it shouldn't and these kind of things. And they all work together. So that's where the value is, and a lot of the value is in the EMS suite. I mentioned that Intune, when you license Intune for your employees, you license for 100% of them. So with all of these, you can license for fewer than all of your employees, right? You can start small, do a handful, do a pilot. Under the agreements you have, you're not required, like if you have the FTE-based agreements, you're not required to license everybody or your FTEs. But if you do license all your employees, then with Intune, or also with Azure Active Directory Premium, and then you will now get students for free. The Azure Active Directory Premium, that is brand new. That's a promo. It happened up until 2 days ago. You AAPP, you were paying for students. The unit price was lower, but yeah, it was still a cost. So that cost has come down if students are. So whereas Intune is your robust, full mobile device management solution, Microsoft just released Intune for Education, which is a much more it's much more user-friendly for a solution for easy and quick deployment. But actually, before I go back, I forgot that I had a nice little video for you guys on EMS. Sorry, I tested this before. There's no quick transition here.
Email, documents, and robust productivity tools is crucial for employees to stay truly productive while on the go. However, the amount of confidential data that is stored within corporate emails and documents can create a significant security risk for organizations if that data ends up in the wrong hands. Microsoft Enterprise Mobility Suite, also referred to as EMS, solves this challenge by delivering comprehensive protection of corporate email and documents across four layers: identity, device, application, and data, while still providing the productivity you've come to expect with Office mobile apps such as Outlook, Word, Excel, and PowerPoint. EMS includes Azure Active Directory Premium, Microsoft Intune, and Azure Rights Management. These cloud services work directly with Office 365 to create a seamless email and productivity experience for employees without compromising IT security. When employees access corporate email and documents on their mobile devices, they expect it to be quick and easy. No one wants to call the help desk for access to email, right? IT, on the other hand, wants to keep corporate data secure, wherever it's accessed from. EMS and Office 365 can solve both these problems. Let's say I'm an employee needing to set up my work email in Outlook. When I first add my corporate Office 365 account in my Outlook app, I expect to get access to all of my emails. But with EMS, IT can enable conditional access capabilities that help to ensure employees can access corporate email only from devices that are managed by Intune and compliant with IT policies. As you see here, I'm currently blocked from my email. Before I can access corporate resources, I need to enroll my device in Intune by installing Intune Company Portal app and going through a few simple enrollment steps. Intune is uniquely able to manage and enforce app restrictions for Outlook and other Office mobile apps to help protect corporate data. Moreover, employees can still use the Office apps they know and love and are not forced to use proprietary productivity apps with limited functionality. Now that you've seen how to require your employees to enroll their devices in Intune before accessing corporate resources such as email and documents, let's take a look at how EMS is able to protect corporate data stored on the device itself. When I first launch Outlook, I'm prompted to enter my PIN, since IT has defined this as a requirement for employees who use managed apps. In one of my emails, there's some useful data I want to keep for a project. But when I try to copy and paste it into my Notes app, it doesn't work, because Notes is a personal app. Instead, if I paste the data into my Microsoft Word app, it works. That's because Word app is managed by Intune. I use Word and other Office apps the same way I always do, so my user experience hasn't changed at all, which makes me happy. And IT is happy since Intune helps them protect corporate data. Now let's go back to Outlook and view an email from a colleague that has an attachment. When I try to open it, I can only choose apps that are managed by Intune to view the file. My other personal apps are not allowed to work with the attachment, so I'll open it in Excel, which is managed by Intune, and make a change in the table. When I try to save the change and place the file in my personal Dropbox storage account, it won't work. Why? Because IT has blocked all corporate data from being stored in any personal cloud storage accounts. Instead, I just save my changes to OneDrive for Business, which is approved by IT. One more way EMS helps keep corporate data secure. Now, there still is a chance that confidential files may end up in the wrong hands, like if I unintentionally forward an email to the wrong recipients. EMS can help with that as well. For example, since this confidential attachment is protected with Azure Rights Management, it's encrypted and only specific people can access it. When I try to open it, Azure Rights Management verifies my permissions by checking my Azure AD identity. It looks like I can access the document, but I only have permission to view the file. This is because of Azure Rights Management's granular controls that protect files by encrypting them, and also by deciding what approved recipients can do with the file. Securing mobile productivity is a classic bring-your-own or choose-your-own device scenario. With EMS, your employees can still have best-in-class email and productivity experiences using Office 365 on their favorite devices, while IT can have better peace of mind knowing that access to their organization's data is comprehensively protected across four layers: identity, device, application, and data. Learn more and try it yourself at Microsoft.com/.
So that gives you a little bit of an idea of puts together some of the things I was talking about. Also brand new then, you know, moving on with overview of what's available cloud-wise, is Intune for Education, which is a somewhat different product. But what's exciting about Intune for Education is that it allows you to quickly deploy devices and applications very easily without a lot of IT knowledge. So, without a lot of time spent. So, it's not to be confused with Intune, but this is only 3 months.
Intune for Education is a cloud-based service that allows schools to manage their Windows 10 classroom devices efficiently and wherever they are. Intune for Education is tailored for schools. Schools of any size will love the ease of initial setup, ease of ongoing management of Windows 10 devices, and the affordability of Intune for Education. When you purchase Intune for Education, we immediately start you off with a number of policies pre-configured so that your devices will stay safe and secure. Express Setup provides a quick and easy experience for administrators to deploy additional apps and customize settings for different groups of devices and users. Your application inventory is synchronized from Windows Store for Business, as well as a list of suggested education apps you can quickly deploy. Here in Express Configuration, we show only the most popular settings for schools and even offer suggested values for a number of settings. Intune for Education supports over 150 settings that you can configure. With the use of auto-enrollment, devices will be managed and automatically receive the apps and settings you've specified when a student or teacher first logs into their device. For schools that need to set up a lot of machines, we offer the free Setup School PCs app that allows an administrator to start managing devices by simply inserting a USB key into the device. This allows you to quickly configure common settings with a single key press. No more typing in Wi-Fi passwords and logging in. Just click and go. While running Express Configuration a few moments ago, we targeted the All Devices group. Most schools want to be able to manage their users and devices with more precision. Intune for Education integrates with Microsoft's School Data Sync to pull in roster data from your student information system, so you can configure apps and policies at more granular levels. With Windows 10 and Intune for Education, applications and settings will follow the user. So if your policies are different across student grade levels or for students and teachers, your users will have a consistent experience no matter which device they log into. Finally, Intune for Education makes it easy for you to configure devices for high-stakes testing. Once configured, students simply log in with a special testing account that has the machine secured for your test content. To summarize, Intune for Education is a very powerful device and application management service suited for schools of any size, yet easy enough for even part-time IT to manage Windows 10 devices in their schools. To find out more, please visit Microsoft.com/education.
Okay, so how many of you guys been looking for Intune for Education, never heard about it yet? I'm starting to get questions in my inbox quite a bit, so wanted to make sure you guys heard about that. All right, so we'll get to things just in brief. So Office 365, it's called the E5 plan, which is relatively new. It's been out for a little while now. Just to give you, let me give you a clear overview of Office 365 in like a minute, because I know that can be confusing. It's when you go to the website, you'll see probably, if you go to Microsoft Office 365 Education, you see E5 plan, right? And look, I've been doing this for 15 years. I love Microsoft. I work for CDW. Pays my bills, right? But one of the things that's frustrating to you guys and to me too is that you only see, like, they only show you the bundles. But you don't understand the nuance because it's not easy to find that information. So here's the scoop. Office 365, first of all, is an education plan. The education plan is free to schools, no prerequisites. You don't have to own a single Microsoft license otherwise to get that education plan. In brief, it covers your email, unlimited archiving for the organization, it's OneDrive for Business. Those mailboxes, by the way, are, it's so big I stopped talking about it about a year ago. It doesn't even matter. I think it's like a gigabyte. It's a 50 gig mailbox. That's what it is. I literally have stopped talking about it every year. You probably know better than I did because I just totally forgot. Huge mailbox per user, all for free. Skype for Business online. SharePoint online. OneDrive for Business. That's a terabyte of storage per user. And a whole bunch of other Office 365 features. All for free, including eDiscovery, Legal Hold, which if you looked at Office 365 several years ago, you have to pay for some of those advanced features like the unlimited archiving and discovery. So you don't need to do anything to get that.
Well, archiving history now? Yes.
Sorry? Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Well,
yeah, so all that's free, yeah.
I didn't hear what
organizational level. So, you know, user, you can set it up so user deletes, but you guys are archiving forever and always and all the time and everything, and it just keeps everything.
This is operating server.
Yeah, exactly. So that's really important just to know, like, that stuff's free. If you have a subscription licensing agreement, like an OBS or EES agreement, and that includes Office, you get Office 365 Pro Plus for free. The names are so similar, it's confusing. Office 365 Pro Plus, full version of Office. Every user, every student, every employee is free if you include Office on your subscription agreement. And that means they can have it installed on 5 Windows and Macs, 5 iPads, and 5 tablets all at once per user. Okay? So no additional costs. And then we go to E5. E5 adds a bunch of stuff. There's some security things like advanced threat protection. So not only an example feature of ATP or advanced threat protection is that it'll open attachments in a sandbox. So if it's a bad attachment, if it's malware, it happens out in the sandbox, it doesn't affect you guys. A bunch of other features in ATP, security features are key. But really, if you're going to look at E5, which you're going to hear people talk to you about, you're probably going to be a fit if you're interested in the telephony pieces. So that's what I'll show you guys the slides on E5. So by telephony, we're talking specifically about broadcast conferencing. This slide, it's easier. Yeah, so Skype meeting broadcast, so up to 10,000 users. So it's a robust conferencing, broadcast solution where you can record and do real time. And attendees can join from anywhere and any place. Again, remember, these are available a la carte as well. Licensing specialists can help you out. It's us, happy to help you, or have your current reseller work with you on this. PSTN conferencing. So you can dial out to bring participants in, or you can use a total dial number. Cloud PBX, so PBX replacement, and PSTN calling. So Microsoft is a telco. They provide phone numbers. When this first launched, they weren't. Now they are. So now Microsoft has calling plans, as well, and these are bundled into the E5 plan. So there's a lot to unpack here. We had 35 minutes. Like I said, today's purpose was just like a wet and whistle, and let you know what's out there, and make sure that you're asking questions pertaining to, hey, but what if I don't need all that stuff? Right? After 15 years as a licensing specialist, that's the best advice I can give anybody, is make sure you're asking the right questions and looking for the nuance and how things are offered to you. So some more slides on meeting broadcast, dial in and dial out, phone number provisions. Again, these slides are going to be for your reference. And geo availability is not as big a deal for you guys in K-12. Unless you have some special program, I know you might be working with schools overseas or something, it's kind of rare. But this is the geo availability of that. So remember, so in summary, E5, it's all the telephony pieces, it's got advanced security features as well. And I know I just skipped one, I'll go back to the slide and move on to Azure Infrastructure as a Service. Need to think about with respect to E5.
We're on an E3.
You are an E3, which means you have the equivalent of what's now the things I talked about, which is the EDU plan, which is free, mm-hmm. and Office 365 Pro Plus. So if you combine those two things, which if you have Office on an Office subscription, they're free. Yeah. If you did it early on, you got E3, you probably paid for it at one point.
No?
Okay. Then you were in that, there was like all these transitions. But yes. So you have E3, which is Pro Plus and EDU combined. So any of you who don't have E3, you get the free things I told you about. That's the equivalent of what used to be E3. Yeah. So yeah, the names are driving nuts, but those are things you have. So the last topic is Azure, which can be confusing because Microsoft uses the name Azure to everything that's the categories of services that you can do in the Microsoft public cloud. Right? Everything from media services to storage, disaster recovery. I mentioned common ones, but there are many more, but big data stuff, you name it. But I want to give you an idea of how I recommend you think about Azure if you're just in the early stages of thinking about it. If you simplify it down to, what are the workloads that I have in my data center, and which ones are good candidates for the cloud, or that's not even right. I would say, which ones are good candidates to think about for the cloud? Because it's not about a question of, am I ever going to use public cloud? Chances are, eventually, most organizations will, or something or another. It's really a question of, which workloads make sense, and why do they make sense? Can I quantify that? Because I need to know for my own sake and your jobs, and also obviously to the rest of your organization and the other stakeholders. So, if you want to begin the journey, don't mind the sort of cliche concept, right? Common beginning solutions, things that have good economics, that are easy to get started with, right? So they don't take big investment in learning compared to some other things. And also time savers, which also relates back to economics, right? Virtual machines, storage, disaster recovery. These are probably the top three workloads in education institutions that people start with in Azure, especially in virtual. So that's really simply what you want to know. Now we have some offerings, some tools that are free that you guys can use to help evaluate existing workloads and compare them to costs in Azure. I'll talk a little bit about how that's, how you pay for Azure, how that transactional piece works, because that can be confusing. But I'll give you a little taste of that, so that when you have a conversation, whether it's with me or your other reseller, you have some basis for the conversation. But so think about, what's the workload? Because if you can think about that and you're communicating with us, it's easier for us to help you get to where you want to go. You can just say, look, these are things I want to, need to buy a new server anyway. Is this a good time to think about putting this workload in Azure? A lot of times you guys can go right to the public-facing Azure webpage, and it's really pretty user-friendly. Being a non-IT person, I find that I can go there, and if I just hear a few basic things of what you want to do, I can usually go and figure out, this is what you're doing, here's approximately what it'll cost you, and here's what the offerings are. So for example, if you went to the calculator and you look for virtual machines, it'll give you a list of different specs that are available, different size machines, VMs, and what the per unit cost would be. I put the calculator link in here, but we don't have to go there now. So workload, define the needs more specifically in Azure. The calculator can do the trick, but also, which you can do yourselves, you can work with either Microsoft or your reseller, including us, if you like. And if you have a more complex workload or you just want to understand the technical speed bumps that might occur as you're going to go do this, we can help you with that and have a more technical conversation as well. So that's something you want to do. Again, it's not about whether it's CDW, but whoever you talk to, you want to be able to have that conversation with somebody to help you understand, I've got a complex solution, which knobs and switches are going to get turned on in Azure that are going to cost me money, right? Because the meter is going to run for whatever service. So for example, it might include networking costs, it might include storage. You pay for every little thing, but it doesn't mean everything's expensive. A lot of things, there's a meter on them, but they're often negligible in cost. So don't let that scare you away. Just you need somebody to tell you which pieces and parts go into it. Just like an on-premise solution, right? If there's multiple pieces and parts, that I know what all those are. Same in the cloud, it's just you're looking at it a little bit differently. And then finally, what you're coming up with is an annual cost of consumption. And it's in terms of consumption, based on our shifted time frame. Consumption is going to be based on whatever the unit of measure for that service. So like virtual machines, you pay for based on time per minute. storage. It's based on, it's actually two factors. It's number of instances, and then it's, you know, the amount of storage. So every meter is a little different. That's where having a good licensing person will help you as well. But whatever those meters are, right, you can come up with an estimate, and the transaction is never going to be those individual things, right? Nobody's going to give you a bill of materials for those. What happens is instead is you say, all right, I'm going to spend $5,000 a year based on the workload. So you buy, you put in money into your Azure account up front. It's called Azure Monetary Commitment. And that amount, when you get access to your Azure portal, the funds get deducted from that initial amount. So you can either top off, call it, by just purchasing more monetary commitment as you get closer to running down to pulling that down. It's based on your EES agreement, so the term of that, if you put in $5,000, it doesn't roll over to the next anniversary. You want to make sure that you're buying less than your estimate, because you don't want to have money sitting there and have it go away. Then it becomes a really expensive solution. Instead, what you want to do is you want to let it run into what's called overage. So in other words, you'll start to get billed like you do for your electricity, which is after you've used it, rather than pay for it upfront. It's just that the first time you have to do that initial monetary commitment. Does that make sense? So put in something upfront, that's what gets you access to your portal, it opens the door for you, and then after that, let it run into overage. The rates are identical, no extra fees or anything, so you're not paying more. But it is a different business process, and some of your organizations might have to, struggle with, budgeting and paying for stuff after you've used it and getting, maybe hit with overages. So it's a management change for all of you and for your business offices. But that's the nature of the cloud in general. It's not unique to Azure. Anything to do with public cloud and infrastructure, it's kind of good. So these are, some of the changing things of our times. So that's kind of a summary. So like I said, we have some tools that we can give you guys access to that will help you evaluate existing workloads and compare them in cost to what they would cost in Azure. CloudPhysics is one of them. This is a free tool that